It's Showtime with Mary Honan, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. each Saturday.
I had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a man, man cub.
Wherever you are, we're here.
And be just like the other man, because I'm tired of monkeying around. Oh, oopie-doo, I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Cheek. Talk like you.
Díogaibh go léir a cordia agus tofáil to road. Welcome to It's Showtime with me, Mary Honan. And I'm absolutely over the moon now to have my guests that I have tonight for the show. I have in Mallow, I'm going to start there with Brenda Springer-Boylan, who's an Irish dancing teacher and adjudicator of some huge renown. Up on the far corner, I have her daughter, Sharon. Sharon, what is your marriage name now, Sharon?
Lynch.
Sharon Lynch, but she's Sharon Boylan also. And her beautiful daughter, Sarah Kate. And you're there in Long Island. And yeah. Down on my left at the bottom, I have Billy Barry, all the way from Mallow. So they're very well connected. In the sense that Brenda is an Irish dancing teacher. Of course, we have Sharon and her daughter who are related to her. But Billy, being from Mallow, is also an ex-pupil of Brenda's and friend of Sharon's. So, Brenda, tell me what it was like being an Irish dancing teacher. And
in the good old days, Mary,
yeah.
You mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, now it is definitely totally different now to the time I was teaching, because at that stage you got up on the floor, you danced away, you finished, you walked out the door. There was no such thing as warming up or exercises or anything like that, which I'd say ruined an awful lot of my era's feet, because it certainly ruined mine.
Really?
So, yeah, I think what the way it's going now, it's much, much better, much more professional. And it's good for the kids because they're exercising and they're doing warm-ups and warm-downs and all the rest of it, and stretches, which we never, never did. And that was a big problem, not then, but now, especially for all my era of teachers.
Yeah, I think you're right, because, I mean, any one of us who came up in the 60s, 70s, 80s, that kind of way, you're plagued with repetitive strain injury and people have arthritis, and the amount of knee replacements and hip replacements
they've
had to have, that they don't seem to have nowadays, because they have all the benefits. Sharon, did you go to dancing? To Brenda.
I did, for a long time. I didn't ever get very far. I think I stopped when I was around 14, maybe.
You did, yeah. Yeah, around that time. You were a champion at 6.
I peaked at 6 then.
I still have that photograph, actually.
It doesn't count.
Yeah, and you didn't have the love for it. That's...
I did. Oh, no, I really did, but I actually have ankle issues.
Yeah.
Congenital, not due to Irish dancing, but it definitely, I couldn't dance, it was painful, and but I loved it. I loved everything about it, and I especially loved the trips that we did with the folk dancers that Billy would have been on.
Yeah, and Billy Barry. Billy, you said the funniest thing on the last show that I was interviewing. I still laugh at it. I actually wake when I think of it, what you said about when I said your brother Pat went to Brenda to dancing, and you said that if there was 10 of us, 10 boys, and there was only 2 of us could dance, the other 8, if they were hanged for being dancers, they'd have died innocent men.
That's brilliant.
I heard that, Billy, and he's right, because a lot of the dancers that came into the folk dance group afterwards, they came in from the pipe band, and none of them ever danced as children. There was only Billy and John Stack and Johnny Lucy.
And Tommy Hanover. You,
and Tommy Hanover. That's right, yeah. And you all came in at a very early stage, but you were always very, very promising. from the time you started?
Well, you know, I kind of see indoors. I remember when Brenda, you'd come into the class that time, this tall, thin, black haired, very good looking woman, and all very young that time. And I suppose in those days, you know, once we finished national school, then you kind of, you'd be left at it, I suppose, in a way. So we just kind of gave it up then. And I didn't find it again until, you know, we joined the folk dancers and I was in my early 20s again, you know. And then, like, we had fierce fun and enjoyed dancing then very much. Yeah.
And you see Billy's photograph behind him there, Brenda?
The hero.
No.
Yeah.
All right.
He put it up there specially for you.
Good man, Billy.
In case you didn't remember who he was, you know.
Just in case you didn't remember. But Sharon, you moved to Long Island. How many years are you in Long Island now?
Would you believe, as of 3 days ago, I'm here 32 years.
What?
Your mother's shocked over that.
I'm shocked as well. I can't believe it was that length. I would have said, I'm
1988.
And what part of Long Island are you in?
All the way out east in Southampton, actually.
Yeah. Out in the Hamptons.
Yeah. It's lovely. I have to say, when I first arrived, I knew I was going to New York, but I didn't know that Southampton was as rural as it is. I mean, I was a bit excited about, you know, being in New York, you know, near the city and all the rest of it. And as we're driving out from the airport after I got picked up, I'm watching trees going by and I'm like, where did the city go? I had no idea it was going to be so rural, but I love it. I mean, I love it now.
It took you a while to get used to it, I'd imagine.
No, I kind of took to it straight away because I had only intended to come for the summer. And had intended to go home after that stint, but I didn't. I really loved it. Honestly, I took to it like a duck to water, I think.
And then you had.
I often think, what if I'd gone back after that summer? I mean, you know, two roads diverge in a yellow wood. It's like what might have been. But I'm so glad.
To be your destiny.
Absolutely.
Do you know, my mum used to have a saying, what's for you doesn't go past you.
Oh, that's a good one.
And yeah, I don't. True. And I, as you get older, you start to think, actually agree with that. But then Sarah Kate took the reverse way. So it's Sarah Kate's your only child.
She is. I have 5 other stepchildren, but Sarah's my only.
And favourite.
And favourite. And Sarah Kate actually moved to Ireland to study in Trinity.
I did, yeah. I was there for the past 4 years.
Did you love it?
Oh, stop. I can't. I love it. So I loved it so much. I still consider myself there. I say I love it. But I spent every summer, Mum and Dad and I would go down to Ballyclaw, which is close to Mallow. And we would spend every summer there. And when I was looking at colleges, I had gone to boarding school, so I had done the whole boarding American experience and
being away from home.
Yeah. Yeah. So a part of me was just like, what if I, you know, took a leap and went international? And I remember I went to Mom and I was like, oh, what about, you know, these English schools over in London and everything? And she was like, well, what about Dublin? And I was just like, oh yeah. So I looked at Trinity and we went to visit it. And from the moment that you step through the doors, I mean, when you walk through the front doors of Trinity, you feel just it's so grand.
Yeah.
I don't know how to describe it. A lot of other people say that they don't know how to describe it either.
Yeah. It's very enclosed. It's very protected. What, Sharon?
I said, I remember her walking through the arch and she stops and she looks and she's like, I have to be here.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's uplifting when you walk in and you see all those buildings around.
Yeah. It was definitely an experience. And I had they give you a little picture of Trinity Front Square when you go on the tour. And I had it boarded above my desk at boarding school. And that was just my goal for, you know.
I'm shocked you didn't try UCC and have your granny to live with.
I looked at UCC. No, I really looked at UCC and I was blown away by their campus as well, actually. They have a gorgeous campus down at UCC.
Yeah, but I mean, what's different about Trinity, I suppose, is the history behind it, the architecture, the square when you walk in, and this feeling of being cloistered and being, you know, everything being in one space. It almost looks quite contained.
It does. I mean, Dublin is small, by a very small city, but it's still quite bustling, and especially College Green. And then as you step through Trinity, I mean, you still have to elbow your way through a million tourists, but you, as you step through, it's kind of, it's quieter, and you feel kind of, it's a very safe space, if that makes sense. That's the
Yeah, it does. It perfectly makes sense. We'll get back to you again later now about having to be forced out of, if you like, to complete your final year over COVID-19 and to move back home, which was terrible trial, really. And an injustice in a sense, because you've been deprived, if you like, of your last year, that year when you could be out with your friends here in Dublin and celebrating final year, you're back home. It's almost like an anticlimax in some respects.
Why Geese with Dr. Mary Honan, each Saturday from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. and repeated at 1 a.m. Wherever you are, we're here.
But Billy, yes, what was it like being part of the Springer-Boylan School of Irish Dancing?
It was an absolute blessed. I'll tell you now, we had the greatest time and the greatest fun in the folk dances, because, like, Brenda being a wonderful choreographer as she is, and apart from that, she was a good friend to all of us, and we had a great time, great fun. Everything was about enjoying yourself, and we did that, you know, and as well as doing our piece to the best of our ability when the chips were down. It was fantastic. I remember the only time that she ever rendered me speechless. You know, we all had different dances we were involved in. I never did Trip to the Cottage, because it was four lads doing that. I do, you know, the other ones. And but one night we were doing a very special show down in Charleville, and one of the lads that was in Trip to the Cottage was late. So Brenda just said to me, "You're in this now." And Galvin, who was in Australia now for donkey's ears.
Yeah.
I danced with Anne, and Brenda was at the side of the stage, and she said the only time in her life she saw me speechless, because Anne had talked me through the dance while we were doing it. Like, I watched it a million times. I never danced it with them, but we got through it, no problem. But I was completely speechless and in shock when I came off.
It's not the easiest of dances to do if you have to be guided through it.
Yeah, we got there though. But I'm just saying, we always kind of plugged together. It was a great group. It was great fun, great camaraderie in it. And our trips were, well, like,
legendary.
Yeah, they're for a book and a film.
Yeah. Do you think you might actually write a book, Billy, on your time with the Springer-Boylan School of Dancing?
Well, I actually am writing a book for the last 4 or 5 years, and all that's part of it, but mainly about myself, but it's a fictitious character, but I think anyone that will read it, but when they
read it,
will recognise themselves in it.
Oh, well, no.
Don't let that one come out.
God only
knows, Billy. God only knows what's going to be in that book.
I know.
Because I never knew what you were going to do or what you were going to say, but it was always so funny, and it kept everybody amused and happy. It really did. I don't think we'd have lasted without you. You were the life and soul of the whole thing. You really and truly were.
That's lovely to hear. And when I was talking over the idea with Sharon and Brenda about doing this show, both of them were just, even Brenda said to me, Billy has to be on it. I'm so excited about Billy coming on, because he kept everybody going. And, you know, I just felt it was a nice show, because we had three generations of the Boylan family, if you like. And then Billy, who's although you're not a blood relative, you're part of the family.
Yeah, for donkeys, yeah. So we were always, like, for donkeys' years, we were always connected, and we lived in Brenda's house. Like, we had great fun, and, you know, we were all like a big family, Brenda. We were all, you know, always, even with the folk festival, it was a progression from the folk dancers. Mm-hmm. And like that went on for a good 10 or 12 years after that, and fantastic. So that's another show in itself. Like, folk festival was tremendous.
Brenda's, yeah.
Brenda's a child, and one of our many children she had.
None of them genetic, just Sharon.
Just Sharon.
Yeah. Sharon, were you an only child?
No, two brothers.
I don't know why I thought you were an only child as well. And I was just thinking, my mother was an only child and I was. And I was just thinking, oh my God, for one second, was Sharon an only child and Sarah Kate? Yeah, no.
Sarah Kate is kind of unique in that she has...
I'm the youngest and the only, which makes me a nightmare.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah, I was the same, the youngest, the oldest, and the only.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I can't imagine how tough it was to raise me anyway. But they definitely...
You were an absolute joy.
I bet.
You were, actually.
You were, I like the way she said you were.
It was a joy.
Must have been very hard, so, Sharon, sending her off to boarding school.
Oh,
please. Being the only child.
Yeah, and she was 13. I mean, I think that was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. I mean, honestly, that was so painful. And she nearly came home, but she had to stay for a week.
I'd stay for a few weeks.
Yeah, for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Because we paid in advance for the term and taken insurance, and the insurance made it that she had to spend 2 weeks on campus before we'd get the tuition back. So we're going to bring her home again. I mean, it was just so hard. And I could tell within a week, the way she was talking, that she wasn't coming home. And poor Jim never got over it. He's like, he thought he was getting her back.
Yeah.
And then she decided to, you know, I'm not coming home. I love this. Yeah, it was painful.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can't imagine how tough it was, but it was one of those situations where I was around so many different people and I was living with so many different people. And I mean, I obviously, being an only child is great, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, I know.
I really enjoyed living with other people my age and kind of hanging out with them. And I mean, Garrison, my boarding school, was a great experience. I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah.
It definitely set me up to be a bit more independent and a little less only childish. I wouldn't trade it for anything. It was a great experience. I mean, I was very young, but it was...
Your dad still hasn't gotten over it.
No, he still talks about it.
But, yeah, she's a daddy's girl.
Oh my God.
Yeah. But, oh, definitely.
It was, yeah, I mean...
But it's kind of the way you were saying, Mary, like, what's meant for you won't pass you by. Like,
no, I was thinking that as she was talking.
Yeah, like she's done the full circle now, you know, back to Ireland after I left it. And she's thinking about certainly spending, you know, maybe making that more permanent, depending on what crops up for her career-wise.
Moving to Ireland?
Yes, it's a matter of, I mean, with everything that's happening right now, you don't know which way anything is going. I was planning on doing a master's here for a year, which I'm still planning on doing. But I do have this, you know, thought in the back of my head. You know, I'm not done with Ireland. I really enjoyed my time there.
Yeah, so, it is one of these countries that seems to have a mystical pull on people. I was born in England, and so when we were asking you off camera whether you thought you saw yourself as Irish or American, and you said the jury's still out. I always felt that way as well, as an English born person living in Ireland with an Irish mother who always saw me as Irish. And of course, my father's side of the family saw me as English. So you grow up kind of not sure what you are, but knowing that you're both, which is great as well.
Yeah, it was one of those things, actually. I recently since I did political science and sociology as a master's, I'm as an undergrad, I did a small stint at an internship at the Irish Embassy in DC. And it was the first experience that I had being an Irish American in America, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
There were Irish events that, like, people from Ireland came over, the Shannon rugby team came by, you know, when I was over in the embassy, and we did a reception for them, and I actually got to know this group of Americans that play rugby, and they call themselves the Washington Irish rugby team. And so I got to know them while I was in DC, and I remember I was sitting, I was kind of working with the press secretary at the time, and the ambassador was doing a interview regarding the Irish diaspora in the US and everything like that. And I kind of had this emotional moment as I was listening, because, you know, he was talking about how, you know, you can be as far away as you want from Ireland, but you're still Irish and you still have this.
Yeah.
Connection, and I had just never seen it that way.
Yeah.
You know, because I would spend my summers in Ireland, and then I'd come back and I'd have some weird Long Island Cork mix of an accent that just like was so weird. It, like, thinking back, I can't imagine how awful that sounded. But, you know, it was definitely a really nice kind of awakening to see that I could be both. And
yeah, I know what that's like, because when I came here, my mom was very ill for a long time when I was a child, so I was back and forth to England. My dad was still there, so I was get on a plane in Shannon. He and his family would pick me up in England. So by the time I came back, I never lost my English accent until I was 14. But when I'd come back, I'd have a Welsh English accent, because my grandmother's side were all Welsh. And my poor mother then hadn't a clue what I was saying.
Yeah.
And then when Dad came home, finally got a job here, he was so quiet, she'd say to me every now and again, "Mary, what's your father saying?" So I'd have to, and I mean, they were both speaking English, and she'd say, "Oh, for God, what's your father saying?" Because she had a hearing problem. And so I'd have to, every time he'd say something, I'd have to repeat it. So I was kind of like, I felt like an interpreter at times. But what was I going to say? Sharon, you were involved in radio here in Ireland.
Oh, NCLR, when it was, yeah. Yeah, it was the illegal radio, pirate radio.
Yeah,
I remember it well.
Wasn't it great? I loved that. Of course, I had the graveyard shift. I got Sunday afternoon when nobody's listening. but it was still fun. And we used to mix our, I mean, I could mix my, I had the mixing desk. I had all my own, you know, did it all myself. No technicians. Learning how to sing in and out with the music. It was absolutely great fun. Mum was on it as well.
Yeah, I know. But you were a teenager when you were on it.
I was. I used to actually, after school, I would do the 5 o'clock news and the 6 o'clock news when the main I can't remember their names.
Michael Sullivan was one. You were very posh, giving out the news, very posh voice.
Do you remember that?
I do, of course. I remember being up, giving Brenda a hand one morning at a show she was doing. And of course, she was, you know, filling all these little bits and pieces as you would. And she was calling out this recipe for some kind of a cake. But, you know, out of a book, obviously, like, couldn't be out top of her head. we were coming downtown after to go for a cup of coffee, and obviously, there'd be people listening to the show. And a woman says to Brenda, "I love that recipe that you called out there on the show. You know, I have no idea," said Brenda. "I just got it out of a book."
Yeah. You didn't get into cakes baked at home. I mean, Mum, you were so busy with the dancing classes all over Munster.
That's right.
Yeah, but one thing I remember about the about NCCR was, as you say, I took stuff out of books. But I was, one stage I gave some kind of a remedy to clear stains from a cardigan from wool, and called out the recipe and what to do. You had to mix two or three things, And the next thing, when I went out the next morning, Michael O'Sullivan was there, and Michael said, "Brenda, you're in awful trouble." I said, "What in the name of God did I do now?" He said, "The recipe you gave out, two people have rang in and they've ruined their sweaters and they're looking for compensations." No, he didn't, they didn't do anything about it, you know, but he was only kidding me when I went in. But it did happen. That did happen. And I think afterwards there were another two or three people that rang in and said that recipe was dreadful. We've ruined some good sweaters. And they did. That was the one thing.
Did you do any radio, Billy?
No, I used to be on a Sunday, right, with Liam Gallagher and his show now and again. I do stuff and a few songs and things like that, you know. But I didn't present any show. No.
Do you want to do some Shanachie piece?
I don't mind a bit. So.
Oh, do please, Billy. Yes. Do.
A fierce argument cropped up in our house one night between Connie and Casey, a thin, wiry little fella, and Betty O'Brien, a big, fat man and a historian to boot, as to who was the first Irishman to set foot in America. Well, we all know that, says O'Brien, it was St. Brendan the Navigator, although he kept his mouth shut about it. Can you prove that, says Casey? Oh, I can prove it, says O'Brien. St. Brendan the Navigator was born in Fenis in the County Kerry in the year 500, and he died in Annacoing in the County Galway in the year 580. Now we'll take it that he did his navigating in his prime, say between the years of 525 and 540. Add all that up and take it from the present day, and it'll bring you at a hymn's kick of 1400 years since St. Brendan discovered America. Is that all you know, says Casey? Irishmen were going to America long before that. But if there were, says O'Brien, you can prove it. Oh, I can prove it, says Casey, because if I couldn't, I wouldn't have drawn it down. My great-granduncle, Tate Flora, he was going to America one time, and they were becalmed about 200 miles out from the County Clare, so they threw down the anchor and went to bed for the night. So what did they want up for? In the morning, there was a stiff breeze blowing, and when they pulled up the anchor, what do you think was going to the end of it? Only the wheel of a horse cart. And what does that prove, says O'Brien? It proves, says Casey, that Irishmen were going to America by road before the flood.
I remember that one, yeah.
Used to tell that one?
He used to, yeah. He had some great ones. But, you know, I often think Billy and Sean O'Shea have a lot in common, because Billy went from dancing and into the Shanachie. Sean O'Shea, with his singing, always included Shanachies in his performances.
Yeah, yeah.
But Brenda, have you seen, you wouldn't have seen them, Sharon, but Billy puts on some extraordinary plays. And I only saw one now, and I was blown away by it, by the production and the acting. And I just thought it's something that should be shown on a bigger stage than the little stage that it was.
That's right.
That should be shown maybe in the Gaiety or in Limerick, in the Bell Table or in the Lime Tree Theatre in Mary Immaculate.
Yeah. I always think, you see, with amateur drama, because I'm producing plays there for 20 odd years, but amateur drama, I in my estimation, is always very honest compared to a professional setup, because people give everything they have to their performance, and I always think that's why we get a very honest and a better show sometimes than the professional side of it, you know?
Yeah, you're right, Billy, yeah.
Actually, Gary, Billy...
God knows, when are we going to see the next lot of shows and drama and all that sort of thing? When is that going to come back?
Brenda, how are you doing with the cocoon, you know? How are you doing at home? Are you all right?
Oh, I'm grand, yeah. I'm enjoying it, actually.
Yeah.
I got very, very lazy. At the start, I cleaned out all the wardrobes and all the drawers and everything. And then I thought, I'm going to sit out now and enjoy the sun. Because there was nothing else to do.
In the local paper, Brenda Springer cleans out her drawers.
Sharon, what were you going to say there?
I was going to say that Billy's been keeping us all occupied and amused by doing Shenachie's on his Facebook page, which has been fabulous. I think I've watched everyone twice.
Yeah, yeah, they're very good. You should put them up on YouTube, Billy. That way more people can see them.
Possibly, yeah. And Sharon, sorry, no, Mary, but I want to ask Sharon, what about your painting? I saw that most beautiful.
I was just going to get on to it.
God, are you still painting?
I'm still painting. I'm actually working on a fine art degree, and I won't be done till I'm 100, I'd say, because I can only take a class or two a year.
Something done before then, because I'd be definitely gone. If you were 100, I'd be long gone before you.
I know, Billy. You're hardly going grey as it is. You'll be around forever, I'd say.
What way are you doing the course, Sharon?
It's actually online, believe it or not. It's Academy of Arts University in San Francisco, which about 10 years ago, really set up a very comprehensive interface to be able to do an art degree remotely. Because, I mean, really all I'm, what you really do miss is that the energy of other painters around
people.
You. Yeah. And, you know, bouncing ideas off each other and looking for critique and feedback. But it's really very comprehensive. You know, like if it's class that's involved with color, I actually have to ship the work out there because they won't accept, you know, you can change colors on the computer.
Yeah.
Most of my work gets uploaded, critiqued by the professors, feedback, and I get it back. And then if it's a more liberal art, like an art history class, the town library here proctors exams. So the university sends the exams to them, and then they lock me in a room for 3 hours and then they send it back. So it's
I've seen your art, and I wanted to actually put some of it up, and I planned on putting some of it up. And Brenda said Sharon does not want her drawings up, and I thought, oh no, because I just think they're extraordinary.
Fantastic!
They really are. No, Mom does not give herself credit.
All right. And I have an arts degree.
Sure, I know you do. So that's one of mine there.
Just wonderful. And I'm not plumbing you, as they'd say here in Ireland. It's a fact. You have to be honest.
She does, yeah. Mom, go down to the basement and grab.
So this is the landscape that I just got done with. That's the
I love them, Sharon. I really do love them.
That's fantastic, yeah.
Thanks.
You can feel Sharon, the energy. You can feel the waves.
But my problem is showing work, like nothing's ever finished. It drives Jim crazy. My her dad crazy.
We stuck for a life model.
Oh, okay, thank you, Billy.
Billy, have you seen the life model drawings she's done?
No. I'd have to lose a lot of weight and get my six pack back.
Back to dancing again, Billy.
I know.
You drop a few stone in a week.
But yeah. Sharon, that painting now that you showed there, did you tell me, or was I imagining it, that tree on top was blown away in the storm last year on the top of that
that tree is the famous cypress by Pebble Beach Golf Course, and it's actually their symbol. And it was two years ago, I think, the larger branch of that of the cypress was sheared off, and it doesn't exist anymore. And it was actually like the tree was it was taken care of by the government. They went in and, you know, they were determined to keep.
Isn't it extraordinary though?
Yeah.
Isn't nature extraordinary, the way it can actually grow out of a piece of rock and surrounded by water and in. Before the break, we were talking there to Sharon about her love of art and her involvement in the art college, and her paintings, her magnificent paintings. Really, you need to go on her page and see them, because she's much too modest to blow her own trumpet. There's a saying, a friend of mine has it, everyone needs a dog to bark for them.
That's true. And, very true.
And so I mean, you should look at her art. But what got you involved in that, Sharon?
I'd always wanted to go to art college, and I didn't, as you know. I came here when I was 21, and really the internet blew, you opened the world for everybody, you know. So that even though I was working full-time when I began, I was able to, you know, I was able to do it because, you know, I mean, there was no way I could take time out of my life to go to a physical art college, which I would have loved to do.
Yeah.
But for me, you know, it's like, I mean, I'll never do anything with this degree other than the pride of having it and having worked for it. But I'm learning every single day. I mean, I've learned so much and I've improved so much. And it's just wonderful to do.
Yeah. And you've learned beyond art. You've learned timekeeping and getting things finished on time and creating something and working hard. But you had that from the dancing. That would have been instilled at the earliest age of this work ethic and never being 100% perfect. Some people, I think that they're perfect the minute they do something. But I think if you grow up in Irish dancing, you learn very quickly to just keep going, that it can always
work
be better.
Work at it. Have to work,
I'm full of sayings today. There's a saying I saw which was actually fantastic. It says, hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard.
Oh, very good.
That's very good.
That's very good,
Mary. Yeah. Isn't that very good?
That is, yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
So, Billy, you loved the dancing.
I loved it, yeah. I loved it for the short time I was in the Irish dancing. I remember I won a medal, Brenda, with you up in the old stage in the town hall in Mallow.
Yeah.
The first stage I was in, I won a medal, and I still have it.
You were very promising, though. You were very promising, Billy. You really and truly were.
Yeah.
When you were younger, you know?
Yeah, and I just didn't carry it on, is it? You know?
You're still promising, Billy.
I'm still promising, and I have still great legs, in fairness to me.
You have.
And Sarah Kate, how difficult was it leaving Trinity and having to rush back without finally meeting your, you know, going off and celebrating the end of the college?
Well, it was one of those things that you don't. I don't think I still realize the magnitude of it. I remember thinking, oh, this is getting serious. And then a few friends who lived in Ireland started going home. And then a few friends that lived over in Switzerland, France, England, all started to go home. And then you kind of just look around and I was like, I'm the only one left. This is quite serious. I hopped on a flight back and, you know, it was it was tough for a while. I mean, I remember mom said one day, she was like, I don't know who I'm getting down the stairs when you come down every day, because just the mood swings where it was quite hard to process.
No, it's understandable.
But, you know, I mean, I honestly wish I had more to say about it. It's just one of those things where you just have to keep going, because
You were saying that there were people that you know that were more acquaintances than friends, that you'll never see them again, probably.
Yeah, it was one of those things where it's just like, I didn't realize I had my final class of uni until a few days later when school closed, you know.
Yes. I understand it, Sarah Kate, from the other perspective. I lecture in a college, a university, and, you know, the amount of students, as I was saying to you earlier, you know, they were the rug was pulled on from under them. One minute they were in class, the next minute they had no class. And, you know, there was so much more that you ended up having to talk them through via emails or via Moodle, which is the computer program that they'd upload their stuff. Some of them panicking because they missed the deadline and thinking that they were going to be late. And we gave them extensions all the time because it's extraordinary circumstances.
Yeah.
One girl, her mother died in the middle of it, and another girl, her father died. And you have to make exceptions for So, you know, when you can see it from both sides of the perspective here in this interview, you see it from the lecturer's point of view, and you also see it from the student's point of view. It was just traumatic, because you go into school not realizing on your final year, that's the last you're going to be. You might even miss that day in class because you might be sick, and realize that you're never going to get that day again, because what you thought was just another day happens to be the last day of the 4 years that you did.
Yeah, it's one of those things. I have to say, I had the best 4 years of my life at Trinity. I did. I had amazing friends. I learned so much. I mean, not only from college, just from people and friends that you meet. And I love Dublin. I absolutely love Dublin. I love living there. I love the people there. I love Ireland. You know, I mean, I don't know, it's one of those things where I didn't realize I was coming up on the end until it hits you smack in the face and you can't do anything about it.
What I was saying to you earlier, you might get a job with Donald.
Yes, yes, he's great to women. So, I mean, I might...
I like that.
But, you know, I mean, I'll probably stick around here and build up some experience and hopefully make my way back one day. We'll see. But,
You might do your master's here.
Yeah, I'm looking at a few master's programs here, so we'll see. But, I mean, Dublin is a great city. I miss it a lot.
Yeah. Well,
you're always welcome back anyway.
Right. So she'll be your nana here.
Oh, stop. Nana saved my life on multiple occasions when I was in college. I would just, there were a few days when I didn't give her notice, and I just hopped on a train from Houston to Mallow. And I was just called her, I'm here. And she's like, okay.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's about.
Yeah.
My uncle lives in Mallow as well. So, I mean, I would hop down to him, and it was great, actually, because I would only really see my Irish family in the summers. And I had this great opportunity to have a whole year with them. Yeah. And thinking back, I didn't use it enough, which is awful to think about. But, you know, I mean, it's definitely, it was a great experience. I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Great. Well, but we're going to end now pretty soon, because your brother Pat wants to do his show at 7:30. And but what was I going to say to you, Brenda? The radio business for you. You were involved in organized a lot of festivals in Dublin, in Cork,
Mallow.
With the radio.
Yeah, we ran the Mallow International Folk Gathering for 15 years, from 1980 until 1995. And then it just got too big and it went out of control. I don't mean out of control in a bad way now, but it got too big, insurances and everything went through the roof. And a lot of the members found it too hard to get to meetings, because it involved an awful lot. I mean, there was a meeting every week, and then the 2 or 3 weeks beforehand, because you were dealing with 6 or 7 international groups from China, from Italy, from Portugal, from Russia, from all over the place. We always had 5 or 6 groups in every year, and accommodation had to be found for them, all that type of thing.
Yeah.
So we finished it in 1995.
Do you regret it?
I do, because it was a great 5 days. We used to close the town off from top at the clockhouse and up at the top of the at the Limerick side, and there were four or five stages going right throughout the day and the night time up to 12 o'clock.
Did you ever get involved in it, Billy?
My boss, yeah.
He did, yeah. Billy was in the organizing committee of it.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
We used to take our holidays and everything around it.
Mm-hmm. We did, yeah. People used to make it their holiday and come back.
And would you think of reviving it, Brenda and Billy?
Not at this stage. You couldn't, Mary, because all the expenses that would go with it, for instance, as I said, insurance and all that type of thing.
We've gone so litigious all over the world now. People will just claim for anything now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's ruining society. It's ruining all the things that could give people pleasure now.
Yeah, but apart from the dancing groups that came in, or the musical groups, or the, we'll say, the brass bands, anything that came in, the Trinidadians, the everything like that, there was also, there was a stage for jazz, a stage for ballads, a stage, there was a stage where comedy went on. There was all sorts of things. But those programs and those stages ran from 2 o'clock in the afternoon to 6, and from 7 until 12 at night. So there was a lot of bookings and everything that had to be done for that, you know? It took a long, long time.
We used to have the International Peace Mass, Brenda, remember that?
That's right, we started off with that every year, and we used to have the Papal Nuncios down and the various. We never went political. It was always a nuncio or somebody like that we got to open.
Sharon?
Oh, it was, yes, yeah. Oh, yes, it was. Yeah, it was. But it was a great 15 years, and people still talk about it, you know? And the likes of Sharon and those, when she was growing up now, she was reared in that. They absolutely loved it.
It was brilliant, yeah.
Yeah.
What's your memory of it, Sharon?
Sorry for interrupting,
but is it Sharon or Sharon?
It depends.
I call her Sharon.
Yeah.
I'm Sharon here in the States, and I'm Sharon at home.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because
Sarah Kay didn't know that.
Yeah, because I got her name. I was at a John B. Keane play, Sharon's Grave.
Oh yeah.
Brenda calls her Sharon.
I still call her Sharon.
And I called her Sharon.
Yeah.
It's not Sharon. What do you call me?
I call you Sharon, all of them. Sharon.
Yeah. Oh, that's
her Sharon.
Well, she'd answer to anything.
Yeah. There's a yellow flower. It's a bush, and I have it outside in my garden and back in front. It's a beautiful flower, and it's called the Rose of Sharon.
Yeah,
and it's a biblical, but it's also called St. John's Wort.
It is, yeah. And actually, I was looking for two of them. I must get two of them because I lost the pair that I had front and back. And but of course, there's no place open now at the moment to get them.
Can you take clippings from them? Can you take clippings?
Yes, you can. Yeah.
If you can take clippings, you can have some of mine. I have it nearly everywhere in the garden, back and front.
Propagate very, very quickly.
What do you do? Just cut off a piece.
What I would do is just cut off a piece, stand it in water for a little while. Sharon now is the one that would tell you there what to do with that, because that's their business. But that's the way I would do it. And then just stick it into the ground, and it'll root anywhere.
I'll take a few pieces for you, Brenda, and when Pat Barry is going down to Billy, he can give it to Billy, and Billy can bring it to Brenda.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, thanks a million, Mary.
You're very well. On that point, I'll just thank you all for coming on the show. You were immense. Your company was fantastic. And most of the time, I didn't have to ask a question, because you just went off in your own little wander down memory lane.
Yeah. And that's what I just want to say. It was an absolute pleasure being on with a dynasty of Springer, Boylan, and Lynch. And thank you for having me.
And we couldn't have done it without you, Billy. So glad that you joined us.
It's like a mutual admiration society.
It is. Absolutely. It is. But I'm genuine about that. I sincerely mean that now. I really do, you know?
Well, given that I grew up with Billy Barry in our house a lot, I your honorary brother right there. So it's great
Lovely.
To see you.
Thank
Mary,
you.
Well, yes.
There couldn't be a better way to end that show than that. Well, Shindera Leshan Clore, that's the end of the show for today. Until the same time, or until we meet again, Lacoon of Day, with the help of God. Bawalam Guler Chiacona, Sonis Agus Gra, I wish you peace, happiness, and love. And G'day Shiv Slán.
Thank you very much, Mary, for having me.
You're welcome. Bye bye.